وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا And those people who disbelieve, they say, هَلْ نَدُلَّكُمْ Shall we inform you? Shall we tell you? عَلَى رَجُلٍ About a man. نَدُلُّكُمْ دَال لَام لَام إِدْلَال دَلِيل What does دَلِيل mean? Evidence, right? And what does evidence do? It leads you to the truth, or it leads you to the point that you're supporting. It leads you to the end, the conclusion. Once you have the evidence, then the argument comes to an end. So, هَلْ نَدُلُّكُمْ Shall we direct you? Shall we lead you to? Shall we point out to you? عَلَى رَجُلٍ Upon a man. And who do they mean by this man? The Prophet ﷺ. Shall we tell you about a man, يُنَبِّئُكُمْ Who will inform you, who will tell you, and يُنَبِّئُ From Naba. Naba is what kind of news? Important news. So why are they saying, he will inform you, he will give you this major important news, out of mockery. And رَجُلٍ رَجُلٍ This is nakira. Nakira sometimes is for the purpose of tahqir. So shall we tell you about this man who will tell you that إِذَا مُزِّقُتُمْ When you all have broken to bits, كُلَّ مُمَزَّقْ Torn to pieces completely, entirely, إِنَّكُمْ لَفِي خَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ That you are going to be surely in a new creation. Shall we tell you about this man who will tell you, who will give you this major news that once you have been shredded to pieces into the earth, you are going to be resurrected into a new creation. This is what this man says. Why did they say this? Out of mockery, out of denial. The word muziqtum, mim zaiqaf, mazq. Mazq is to tear something. And tamziq. مَزَّقَ يُمَزِّقُ تَمْزِيق تَفْعِيل What meaning does that give? تَفْعِيل What meaning does تَفْعِيل give? Crush into pieces just as تَقْتِيل Massacre Similarly تَمْزِيق To tear, break up, crumble into tiny pieces with a lot of شِدَّة So إِذَا مُزِّقْتُمْ When you have been utterly torn to pieces into tiny bits, tiny particles Your bodies have been shredded, they have decomposed, your bones have crumbled, you have completely disintegrated into the earth. كُلَّ مُمَزَّق Mumazzaq is ism maf'ul. And mumazzaq is one that has been disintegrated, one that is torn to pieces. And كُلَّ مُمَزَّق meaning entirely, completely. No part of you remains intact. Every bit of you has been broken up. Every part of you has been broken up. He says that إِنَّكُمْ لَفِي خَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ That you will be in a new creation. What does this ayah show to us? That after a person dies and he's buried into the earth, what happens to his body? What happens to his flesh and bones? Will it remain the same? No. مُزِّقْتُمْ كُلَّ مُمَزَّق You will completely, entirely disintegrate into the earth. Torn to pieces, shredded to pieces, completely finished into the earth. This is why the disbelievers would say, إِذَا ضَلَلْنَا فِي الْأَرْضِ When we have gotten lost into the earth, gotten mixed into the earth, مُزِّقْتُمْ كُلَّ مُمَزَّقْ And then Allah will resurrect people. Amazing. This is why, alhamdulillah. And when a person will be resurrected, how will he be resurrected? فِي خَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ In a new creation. What does it mean by this, in a new creation? That the body in which a person will die, it's not going to be the exact same body that he will rise up with on the Day of Judgment. That body will be made again. You understand? That body will be made again entirely, a new creation. خَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ So for example, if a person died, in the state where part of his body, let's say, got bruised or injured, or part of the body he got cut off, like for example, a person got one of his kidneys donated, or a person died and his heart was taken out, a person died and parts of his body were broken up and used for other purposes, donated for different reasons, or a person, he died and his body was burnt. Now, it's not that those ashes will be brought on the Day of Judgment. It's not that the incomplete body will be brought on the Day of Judgment. No, خَلْقٍ جَدِيد Entirely new creation. This is why, how will the people be resurrected? The men uncircumcised. The way they were born. It doesn't mean they will be small infants. No, they will be big. However, any changes that were made in their body, they will not be there anymore. لَفِي خَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ, in a new creation. And we see that this خَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ, this new creation will also be such that a person will have more strength. More strength in the sense that he will have more emotional strength and also physical strength. That if you think about it, the Day of Judgment will be so long, people will see such horrific scenes, but will that cause them to die immediately? It will not cause them to die. In this dunya, what happens? If a person sees a horrific scene, he goes into a trauma. He goes into a trauma, and the effects of the trauma are so bad sometimes that a person cannot recover for months, isn't it? And sometimes the effect is so bad that a person dies. A person gets a heart attack. But we see that on the Day of Judgment, people will not die. In the hellfire, when people are admitted, will they die? No. So this khalqin jadid will be different. It will not be like the body that you have right now. It will be different. Your body will have more capacity, emotional as well as physical. Similarly, when people get tired, when people get exhausted, what happens? They pass out. Will people pass out on the Day of Judgment? No. They'll be drowning in their sweat, but will they die? No. The sun will be extremely close. Will they burn? No. Similarly, we see that it will be a very, very long day, 50,000 years. But will people sleep? No. خَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ, a new creation. Why is this so? So that the person who deserves reward will experience more reward, will experience the pleasure. That pleasure will not come to an end. He will have the capacity to enjoy. And a person who has to suffer punishment, he has the capacity to suffer the punishment. It's not that the punishment will finish him, it will kill him. No, he will not die. So the mushrikeen of Makkah, what would they say? That hal nadullukum, shall we tell you about a man who tells you that when you have been finished completely, you'll be brought into a new creation? The Prophet ﷺ told people about this major reality. But how did they ridicule it? How did they react to it? By making fun of it, laughing it off. They made fun of it. How is it possible? What a great misfortune that people are being informed of this great reality and they just laugh it off. They just laugh it off. And it's only people who have a non-serious attitude, they are the ones who laugh off major important things. Because a person who is serious, he will take serious things seriously. He will give importance to them. And a person who is not serious, what will he do? Even the most important things, he will belittle them. He will not take care of it at all. He will not give it any attention. This is just like if a person is positive from inside, he will look everything positively. And if a person is negative, he will view everything negatively. They said, أَفْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا أَمْ بِهِ جِنَّةً. Has he invented about Allah a lie, or is there in him some kind of madness? What's wrong with this man? How can he say that we'll be resurrected? أَفْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا. أَفْتَرَى, this is actually a and iftara. A, hamza istifham, and iftara, he fabricated. So has he fabricated upon Allah a lie in this respect, that he is lying about Allah, that Allah has said that the people will be resurrected? أَمْ بِهِ جِنَّةً. Or is there with him some kind of madness? Jinnah is from the root letters Jim, Noon, Noon. And what does Jinnah mean? Insanity, madness. And it's also used for possession. It's from Jinn. What does Jinn mean? Jinn. And what do they do? When they have to harm a person, they possess him and they cover his aql. Right? So a person is not in his right mind anymore. When a jinn, when shayateen harass a person, is the person in his right mind? He's not in his right mind. Similarly, if a person is suffering from madness, is he in his right mind? He's not in his right mind. So jinnah is used for madness, insanity, and it's also used for possession. When a person is possessed by the jinn. So has this man fabricated a lie about Allah, or is he suffering from some kind of madness on account of which he has imagined this? That when people have disintegrated, they will be resurrected again? Because this doesn't make sense. It's amazing how they didn't say, or is he really truthful? They didn't even give that option. that look at them, that either he's very intelligent and smart, that he has come up with this lie and he is deceiving people by lying against Allah, or he has in him some kind of madness, so he doesn't know what he's talking about. بَلِ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ Allah says, rather, those people who do not believe in the hereafter, they are فِي الْعَذَابِ in the punishment وَالضَّلَالِ الْبَعِيدِ in the clear error. How are they clearly in error? That they call the Prophet ﷺ الصَّادِقُ وَالْأَمِينُ. And look at them. When he tells them that you'll be resurrected, they say, أَمْبِهِ جِنَّةِ. Is he suffering from some kind of madness? The problem is that those people who do not believe in the hereafter, they will suffer from punishment. Where? In the hereafter. And in the dunya, what is their state? ضلال البعيد. They are in misguidance, error. What kind of error? That is far from the truth. They are extremely far from the truth. Extremely far from the right way. So what do we see? That a person who does not believe in the hereafter, he suffers from two consequences. What are they? What are they? A person who does not believe in the hereafter, he suffers from two consequences. What are they? Al-Adhab and Al-Dhalal Al-Ba'id. Punishment and Dhalal Al-Ba'id. And they are so far in their error that it's almost impossible for them to come back to the truth. We learn in Surah An-Naml, Ayah 66, بَلِ الدَّارَكَ عِلْمُهُمْ فِي الْآخِرَةِ بَلْ هُمْ فِي شَكِّمْ مِنْهَا بَلْ هُمْ مِنْهَا عَمُونَ Rather, their knowledge is arrested concerning the hereafter. Rather, they are in doubt about it. Rather, they are concerning it blind. Completely blind. This is why, no matter what you tell them about the hereafter, no matter how much you warn them, what happens? They don't get it. They don't listen. Allah says, أَفَلَمْ يَرَوْا Have they not seen? إِلَى مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ To that which is before them and that which is behind them. What is before them? What is behind them? مِنَ السَّمَاءِ Of the sky, وَالْأَرْضِ And the earth. Meaning, مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ What is before them is the sky. وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ Is what? And what is behind them is the earth. So before over here gives a meaning of above them. And behind gives a meaning of below them. So, have they not reflected on what is above them, what is below them, of the sky and the earth? And why is it said, مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ And not, فَوْقَهُمْ وَتَحْتَهُمْ Why has it been said, مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ And not, مَا فَوْقَهُمْ وَتَحْتَهُمْ Why do you think so? Because when you look before you, the sky is all over, isn't it? The horizon is before you, is in front of you. If you just look up, can you have a good view at the sky? You can't. If you just look up, then you only see a part of the sky. Whereas if you're looking straight, then what happens? Then what happens? You look at the entire horizon. It shows you the vastness of the sky. Similarly with the earth, if you just look beneath, then you will see only a part of the earth. Whereas if you look behind, then and you look at the earth, then you get a very large, a huge view of it. So, do they not reflect on what is before them, what is behind them of the sky and the earth? Meaning wherever they go, they have the sky above them and they have the earth below them. Isn't it? Wherever they go, the sky is above them, the earth is below them. They are trapped between the two. No matter where they are trapped between the two. So where can they escape? Where can they hide? They are surrounded from all sides. It's like as though an animal is in a cage, surrounded, locked up. Can he escape? He cannot escape. So, if Allah wants, إِنَّشَ If we wish, نَخْسِفْ بِهِمُ الْأَرْضَ We can cause the earth to swallow them. If we want, we can cause the earth to sink with them. Meaning the earth can open up, it can swallow them anytime. أَوْ نُسْقِطْ عَلَيْهِمْ كِسَفًا مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ Or we can easily send down from the sky pieces, fragments, kisafan, plural of kisfa. Because anywhere they go, the earth is beneath them, so the earth can swallow them any moment, any time. Just think about it. At home, what's beneath your feet? The earth. At your workplace, what's beneath your feet? The earth. At the mall, what's beneath your feet? The earth. On the street, what's beneath your feet? The earth. No matter where you are, the earth is beneath you. Can the earth not open up anytime, anywhere, and swallow you? Can it not? Of course it can. And it's amazing how sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows this to us as well. That people are driving on the road and all of a sudden the earth splits up and 5-6 cars, they fall down. It's amazing how sometimes things are perfectly normal, all of a sudden huge blast, and you see so many of the houses have been swallowed in by the earth. This is the consequence. Just recently I saw on the news that there was a woman, she was in her house, and she heard this huge blast, so she ran outside. And the people outside were wondering, why have you come outside? We heard the blast coming from your house. So they couldn't figure out what it was, and they began searching. And in her bedroom, under her bed was a huge hole that was extremely deep. So a huge hole had formed, and because of that, the huge blast, and everything else was fine, but just a huge hole. An extremely deep hole. And this is not something that's uncommon. So anywhere, at home, at work, at the mall, on the street, anywhere you go, the earth is beneath you. The sky is above you. Anything can come down from the sky, and the earth can also swallow you in. إِنَّ شَأْ نَخْسِفْ بِهِمُ الْأَرْضَ أَوْ نُسْقِطْ عَلَيْهِمْ كِسَفًا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَةً لِكُلِّ عَبْدٍ مُنِيبٍ. And this is surely a sign for who? For every servant who turns repeatedly to Allah. عَبْدٍ مُنِيبٍ. Not every servant. Who will benefit from this? The one who turns to Allah repeatedly. What does it mean by turning to Allah repeatedly? In obedience, in repentance, in seeking forgiveness. Because when he makes a mistake, when he commits a crime, when he disobeys Allah, he knows he is not safe. So immediately what happens? He turns to Allah. Because he knows, I could take the next step and that's it. The earth can open, I'm finished. I could take the next step and something can fall down from the sky and I'll be finished. So the one who is munib, he gets a lesson from this. And what's that lesson? What's that ayah that we learn? A lesson, a sign that indicates Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's power. His power to do whatever that He wants. His power to resurrect. His power to execute anything that He wants within the heavens and the earth. And also, there's an ayah meaning a warning. A warning for who? For those who deny. Deny what? The resurrection. That nothing is difficult for Allah. The entire sky, the entire earth is within His control. We learn in Surah Al-Mulk, ayah 16-17, أَأَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ أَنْ يَخْسِفَ بِكُمُ الْأَرْضَ فَإِذَا هِيَ تَمُورُ أَمْ أَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ أَنْ يُرْسِلَ عَلَيْكُمْ حَاصِبًا فَسَتَعْلَمُونَ كَيْفَ نَذِيرٌ. That, do you feel secure that the one who is in the heavens, he could cause the earth to swallow you and suddenly it would sway? Or do you feel secure that the one in the sky, he cannot send down upon you a shower of stones? فَسَتَعْلَمُونَ كَيْفَ نَذِي. Soon you will know my warning. So in this is a warning that how can a person deny the power of Allah? How can a person be heedless towards Allah? How can a person disobey Allah on the earth that he has made, under the sky that he owns? How can a person do that? Only a person who is extremely proud, who is oblivious to the truth. We listen to the recitation.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.